Gee, that looks a lot like an ending to another game.
What was that sound?
In the time after the first Half-Life came out, developers started to rethink how you make a shooter. Monolith showed they were willing to take action games down a notch with the No One Lives Forever series, a smart first-person shooter with a likable female protagonist, a well-written story with funny dialogue, and some terrific action set pieces. It wasn't a perfect series, but it showed a lot more creativity and intelligence than most other shooters at the time. So when I heard they were making F.E.A.R., a first-person shooter with horror elements inspired by certain Japanese movies, I was excited. I had to wait a year until I had a friend with a computer that could actually run it. And when I finally did play it, it was actually a lot of fun. But is it still fun today? And can it still scare? Let's find out. The game starts out more like a movie, weird imagery between credits. No offense, guys, but you really think the average gamer cares? The setup we're given is that Armacam, a weapons company working with the government, has created an army of clones that can be controlled by a psychic commander. I've already lost you, haven't I?
This is why nobody takes us seriously, military clones.
It's strange for a game to admit its bizarre premise almost immediately. Anyway, the commander, Paxton Fettel, has rebelled and is using his psychic army to take out Armacam in search of something. And he has a nasty case of conspicuous consumption as well. The titular F.E.A.R. is introduced, a government branch devoted to fighting and assessing paranormal threats, which seems to consist of just four people in a small TV station control room. They come up with a pretty sound plan to stop the killing. Paxton controls the clones, so we find him and kill him.
Alright, show of hands. Who wants to bet we still have to kill 1,000 clone soldiers before we can find and kill Fettel?
While you get some help from Special Forces soldiers, it still seems odd that all F.E.A.R. sends out to stop this mass-murdering psychic is you, a guy who gets killed off-screen half an hour into the game, a fat guy who stays at the base making phone calls, and a forensic CSI expert. I honestly feel sorry for her because she has to draw conclusions from a murder scene where everyone appears to have been liquefied down to their bones. I don't think bad puns and cool shades are going to help here. The player character is the mute known only as the Point Man. It's the typical first-person shooter character setup. He can't talk, he can only take orders, push buttons, and shoot things. The general idea behind the mute protagonist is the player is supposed to feel like they are the character in the game. F.E.A.R. is sadly not one of those games, as it eventually forces a backstory down your throat. It doesn't come up until the very end, but the game pokes and prods you in the right direction through backstory and psychic tauntings from Fettel and Alma. Unlike Dead Space, F.E.A.R. is a pure action shooter to the very core. You get ammo and grenades from dead enemies, and you pick up health kits and armor to keep yourself alive. Standard stuff, really. There's a nice variety in the grenade types, and the weapons are fun, if a bit odd-looking. I think the game just models them so that there's some kind of perspective angle or something. My only complaint is that you're limited to three weapons, so you have to choose your guns carefully. I usually stick with the situational weapon of choice, pistols or shotgun. The primary weapon the enemies are all carrying so I don't run out of ammo for it, SMG or assault rifle. And the special gun with limited ammo that I hoard for when the guys in armor show up. For me, this is usually the Needler, because who doesn't like a gun that can shoot metal darts and pin guys to the wall? Besides a good weapon loadout, you're also given the ability to bash things with your rifle with the right mouse button, which is handy when an enemy gets too close or you need to knock something out of your way for a clear shot. I love games that let you melee with your gun. It's something you don't really see outside of F.E.A.R. and Left 4 Dead, maybe. So being able to rifle butt enemies is awesome, but when you bash while jumping or crouching, you do a karate kick. The game highly encourages using this, sometimes making it a one-hit kill. So a shotgun blast or three needler darts to the coconut does squat, but a good roundhouse kick to the chest knocks them down? Well, I guess that makes sense. After all, martial arts always beats firearms. Ooh, sorry. The most potent weapon in your arsenal is your ability to trigger reflex time. At least that's what the game calls its version of bullet time, anyway. A lot of games after the Max Payne series like to toss it in slow-motion gameplay, but F.E.A.R. is one of the few that actually did it well. I'm not sure why they felt the need to include it here, though. I thought this was supposed to be inspired by Japanese horror movies, not John Woo action flicks. The enemy variety is, well, I'm not sure I should even use the word variety, because they're all clones. They only really differ in uniform and weapons, and somehow they get tougher and tougher as you progress through the game. As good as the action is, blasting away at the same four or five guys every fight gets really boring quickly. The game tries to break up the monotony by putting horror scenes between action sets, but I'll get to that later. The only unique fights are the ones where they decide to drop a guy in a mech suit or a giant robot on you. There are also these fast guys in stealth suits, but they attack in groups without any of the normal soldiers to back them up. Plus, they don't really do much to attack you, they just kind of swat you until you knock them out with a Chuck Norris roundhouse. When F.E.A.R. first came out, it was a graphical powerhouse, demanding high system specs and the latest graphic cards to run. Most of those resources are spent on the physics engine, but the game also invested time in lighting and shadows, damage decals, and fog effects. I only bring this up because the graphics are actually used to enhance the game's mood, rather than just making it shiny for the sake of shiny. Shadows can be used to show enemies ahead of you, giving you a chance to ambush them, as well as enhancing the mood during the horror parts. The fog and physics engines help during and after the firefights. It's a little annoying when you miss the enemy and hit the wall because it creates a dust cloud, but it's not terrible and it makes the fight more visceral. Above all else, when you finish a fight with the enemy, the place looks like a fight happened there.
There was a firefight!
It's not perfect by today's standards, but it still does the job admirably. The level design is improved by the lighting and shadow effects, but overall they're average. F.E.A.R. isn't above normal FPS tropes, so you start off in a warehouse district full of unbreakable boxes, followed by a trip through the sewers. The office building levels are the best by far. While the floor plan isn't even close to realistic, it makes for some of the best fights and frights. If you've ever walked through a cubicle farm while the office was closed, you know what I mean. And the shotgun will be your best friend here. I guess the level designers got bored after making office levels because they go back to the industrial sub-basement theme for a while. Why would an office building have pointless pools of water and ladders in their basement? Eventually, you'll discover the source of this whole psychic soldier project with a psychic little girl named Alma. The whole scary little girl with psychic powers thing is an overused trope, plus we don't really get any explanation for all the willy-nilly murdering she does. Some of them make sense later, but the big reveal at the end makes it all the more confusing why she keeps trying to kill you. So overall, she's a cliche, but in the context of the game, it fits well enough. F.E.A.R. actually works as a horror action game because it's not always throwing the scares at you. The action is handled like a tactical shooter game, reminiscent of Counter-Strike, but as you proceed to the next area, a guy appears ahead of you and dissolves into dust, whispering dark secrets from afar. You never know when or how these things will appear, and they're not handled like jump scares. Usually it's just something you catch out of the corner of your eye, and before you figure out what it is, it's gone, which is genuinely more creepy and mood-building than a monster jumping out and screaming at you. Being teleported into one of Alma's horrific visions makes you forget that you're in an action game for just long enough that you're a little off your game when the bad guys attack again. Like Dead Space, F.E.A.R. will sometimes punctuate the appearances of Alma with musical stings, but sometimes it will happen in a corner of the screen you're not looking at and you'll miss it. Probably the one thing I don't like about the horror parts is when Alma starts tossing ghosts at you. Everything's in slow motion, so you have plenty of time to react and swat them away by just shooting them. Yes, you kill ghosts with bullets. No nuclear accelerator-powered positron colliders here. All you need to be a Ghostbuster is guns and ammo.
I blame myself.
So do I.
The plot is very slow to unravel. As you keep hunting for Fettel, you find clues hinting that Armacam is up to more monkey business besides an experimental clone army, which seems to be the only legal thing they do. You know, I've never been a big fan of the whole clone army concept, and it's especially bizarre in this scenario. Are they all copies of just one guy? How did he get picked? Are all the clones the same in skill, and if so, why do they have different ranks and weapons? I gotta admit that it's amusing how this supposedly unstoppable army will freak out and wet their pants every time you ambush them or enter bullet time. Also, if Armor King was invested in making mech suits and power armor for these guys, why did they bother making a clone army to begin with? Mechs or clones, guys, which one is your focus? Did the R&D department just get so much funding that they could juggle two giant defense contracts like this, and just decide to merge them and see if they got Reese's Peanut Butter Cups? Oh, and if you think a private company growing an army of clone soldiers might just be a teeny tiny bit evil, the game pretty much decides halfway through to dispense with the subtlety and makes Armacam flat out evil when their security guards start trying to kill you and other witnesses. Monolith tries to insert a bit of humor into the game via Norton Mapes, an Armacam computer jockey who kind of looks like Wayne Knight from Jurassic Park crossed with Slimer. The meaning of his whole existence is to screw you over, because every computer nerd knows the best thing you can do when your company is invaded by commandos is to mess with an even more powerful guy offering to rescue you. You can always tell when he's been in the area by the telltale trail of cheesy poof bags. Actually, I think Norton might just be a grown-up version of Eric Cartman.
Sayonara,
confirm?
Words cannot describe how much I hate this guy. And while he gets his just desserts at the end, I'm just ticked I couldn't empty my shotgun into his blubberous neck flaps. I'd like to bring up the concept of audio logs in games. We've seen them in a lot of titles like System Shock, BioShock, Dead Space, Doom 3, and even recent titles like Singularity. It's a useful way to flesh out the game world and fill in the background. Fear has something similar, but unlike those games I just mentioned, these are absolutely useless. How it works is you'll come across office phones with messages left on them, and you use the phones to hear the message. This system fails in two ways. Firstly, in every other game you can just pick up the audio log and keep moving, listening to it as you progress. In Fear, you have to stay rooted to the spot because the phone is in a fixed place, usually out of combat, so there's nothing to do but to stand there and listen. Secondly, the messages are useless. Even more useless than the emails from Doom 3, because at least those showed some work and effort on the writer's part. These are mostly office workers calling each other asking why the other guy hasn't called him back, or asking if he's hearing gunshots from his cubicle too.
First message from an outside number.
Hey, it's me. Call me, okay? I'll try your cell phone.
End of messages.
I was expecting a lot out of Fear after knowing this forever, and on the whole, I was satisfied with it. The action is still fun with a challenging but not unfair difficulty curve. The horror isn't that horrible, but even on a replay, it gives a feeling of general creepiness without feeling cheesy. You can get Fear with both expansions for $10, which is a good deal. I didn't touch on the expansions this time because they weren't made by Monolith and they suck royal, so I wanted to save that rant for another time. Anyway, Fear is definitely worth a look if you want a good shooter with some creepy atmosphere, and if it somehow slipped under your radar 5 years ago.
While I definitely rate Fear as being scarier than Dead Space, I wouldn't say it's terrifying. Now that honor I've been told belongs to another game from back in 2001, and was actually written by a known author of horror novels. I haven't actually played this game in years, and it's gotten... dusty. But we're gonna see if this old gem can still shine. Clive Barker's Undying.
Little girls, they make me feel so good. I love little girls, they make me feel so bad. When they're around, they make me feel like I'm the only guy in town. I love little girls, they make me feel so good. I don't care about my one-way mirror. They're right by my cold exterior. They don't ask me questions.
Screw you guys! I'm going home.